We're trying to prove that if A and B are elements of a ring, then A times the additive inverse of B is the additive inverse of A times B. And you really should think in terms of that language, in your mind at least, additive inverse. Not, I mean, yes, you could say negative B, and yes, you could say negative of AB, but these are not necessarily numbers. So is that, does that even make sense? It's more, it's better, and it emphasizes the meaning more if you say these are, that's the additive inverse of B, and this is the additive inverse of AB. So you're trying to show ultimately that A times negative B is the additive inverse of AB. What does that mean? It means if I add it to AB, I should get zero, right? Because that's what additive inverse means. So in your scratch work, that would be the first thing I attempt to do, is to see if I can show that when I add those, I get zero. And again, you say to yourself, well, I only allow myself to use the definition of a ring. Essentially, that's my axioms. Those are the things that I can assume are true. And I hope one thing that pops out right away looking at this expression is that there's an A on the left in both terms that can be factored out. You're really using the distributive property like this, right? That would be the distributive property. And then B and negative B are additive inverses. So negative B plus B is zero. And hey, that's the thing that we tried to prove was zero last time. And eventually, with a little bit of looking at the book, we got that it was zero. We can use previous things that we proved. That seems like the essence of the proof, doesn't it? I've shown A times negative B. Okay, yeah, I said negative. A times the additive inverse of B added to AB gives me the additive identity zero. Can I immediately conclude that this is true? Yeah, you basically can. I mean, you're really also using, if you do immediately conclude that, you're also using the fact that that additive inverses in groups are unique. We've shown this plus that is zero. By uniqueness of additive inverses, that means this must be the additive inverse of that. Okay, so now let's write this out nicely. You could say, by the distributive property, A times the additive inverse of B plus AB is A times, in parentheses, the additive inverse of B plus B. I'm going to separate this into a couple sentences, as I could have combined this into one sentence. Since the additive inverse of B is, well, okay, I'll say it in words, is the additive inverse of B. Okay, maybe I should say negative B is the additive inverse of B. The additive inverse of B plus B is zero. So this is A times zero. We know by a previous property that's been proved, you could quote what theorem it is in the book. I think it's theorem 12.1, part one or something. 12.1. By theorem 12.1, part one, that A times the additive identity is the additive identity. Therefore, by uniqueness of additive inverses, I'm being maybe a little overkill here, in groups, rings are groups under addition, A times the additive inverse of B must be, in fact, the additive inverse of AB. We're done. Praise the Lord. Is this the way the book does it? I didn't look. Let's see. They're proving rule two here. Okay, yeah, they started the same way as us. A times negative B plus AB, factor out the A. And negative B plus B is zero, and we know this is zero. So I was doing maybe a little overkill on the reasoning, but maybe not such a bad idea to do initially here. Okay, then they didn't apply uniqueness of additive inverses. They said adding the additive inverse of AB to both sides yields the conclusion. So they added negative of AB to both sides. On the left, it cancels the AB, simplifying to that. And on the right, zero plus that is that. So just a different style of getting the conclusion. Both valid. Okay. Is this proof valid if instead of ring theory, we were doing vector space theory? And V is a vector space. B is an element of the vector space, so B is a vector, but A is a scalar, say a real number. So this is just a side comment here. Is the proof still valid? And is the fact still true? Is the proof still valid? In other words, well, is this fact still true? Is the scalar A times the additive inverse of the vector B, the additive inverse of AB, AB would be a vector, scalar times a vector is a vector. Yeah, this is all still valid. It's the same argument. With vectors, a scalars times vectors, you do have this kind of distributive property. You can factor the scalar out. And now you're adding a vector and its additive inverse, you do get the zero vector. Of course, in vector space theory, maybe you put little half arrows above zero or something, or try to make it bold face or something, right, with vectors. It's just symbols, so it really doesn't matter, as long as you're clear about what's going on. And then that implies this is A times the zero vector, which can be shown to be the zero vector. And you can also say by uniqueness of additive inverses for vectors, this is the conclusion is true. Because vectors are groups under addition. So what's the difference between vectors, rings and vector spaces? With rings, the multiplication is between two elements of a ring. With vector spaces, the multiplication, which we emphasize is scalar multiplication, is, say, a real number times a vector. It's a different kind of, quote unquote, multiplication is the idea there. And remember how I said ring theory is kind of weird? Vector space theory is actually not quite so weird, at least if you reserve. If you only allow, say, real scalars, vector space theory is a little bit more, less weird. Let's just put it that way, okay? Although we will talk about vector spaces in here and allow our scalars to not necessarily be real numbers. What will they be? Well, they could be complex numbers. They also could be elements from any field, including finite fields. So your list of scalars could be finite. Isn't that weird?